Praise the Lord, saints. Truly giving honor to Jesus Christ this morning because he is the head of our lives. I love him. I thank him. I love him for my health, my life, my strength, the activities of my limbs. God is a good God and he's worthy to be praised. I woke up this morning just knowing that it was a beautiful day. If it was cool, if it was hot, it didn't matter. I just knew it was a beautiful day that God has made, and I wanted to praise him and to rejoice and be glad in it. It's our opportunity just to praise the Lord one with the other. We're going to ask everyone, cross the aisles. We have some guest visitors that are in the congregation with us on today. Make them feel at home. Let them know this is your house too. Whatever they need, we're going to assist you all. And we just want you all to feel at home. So let's praise the Lord one with the other in Jesus' name.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Oh, come on. God is here. Praise the Lord, everybody. Hallelujah. If everyone will take your Bibles into your custodies. And today we'll have our scripture reading coming from the book of Philippians, beginning at the fourth chapter, starting at the fourth verse. Philippians 4, beginning at verse 4. Give you just a moment to find it. Hallelujah. Well, you got to say amen. And as is our custom in our responsive reading, I'll read the first verse, you read the second. I'll read the third, you read the fourth, and as a collective, we will read the fifth. And the word of the Lord reads, rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. Be careful for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God.
And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus.
Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. May God add a blessing to the readers, the hearers, and the doers of his holy word.
My, my, my. Oh, yeah, 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 yeah. Hey. Sometimes silence, when I'm all alone, I can talk to Jesus on my telephone. When I'm sad, he makes me smile. Nobody but me, my God and I. Oh, nobody but me, my God and I. Nobody but me, my God and I. Oh, nobody but me, my God and I. Thank you, Jesus. Nobody but me, my God and I. Listen, I was laying in the hospital bed. The doctor came in my room. Lord, this is what he said. I've done all I can do. Maybe I can do you no good. But Jesus came to my rescue, just like I knew that he would. He wiped the tears from my eyes. He made me smile. I've been talking just me, my God and I. Oh, nobody but me, my God. Thank you, Jesus. Nobody but me, my God and I. You know, sometimes trouble is all around my home. It seems like my enemy won't leave me alone. You know, they call me crazy. I smile when I cry, but I'm be talking, just me, my God, and I. Oh, nobody but me, my God. Thank you, Jesus. My God. Oh, nobody, nobody but me, my God, and I. Thank you, Jesus. Nobody but me, my God, and I. Come on, everybody, clap your hands today. Put your hands together out there. If it ain't nobody but you, your God and I. Oh, everybody clap your hands. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh, my, my. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Hey. Oh, nobody, nobody but me, my God. Thank you, Jesus. Nobody but me, my God. I'll be walking and talking. Nobody but me. Singing and praying now. Oh, he'll be there in the midnight hour. When I'm all alone, nobody but me, my God, and our friends all gone. Nobody but me, my God, and me and Jesus. Nobody but me, my God, and I. Thank you, Jesus. Nobody but me, my God, and I.
Now you can do better than that. I said, put your hands together one more time for Jesus. Truly, indeed, we thank each and every one of you again who chose to worship with us today here at Greater Bible Way Temple, located at 3410 Old Selma Road, where our pastor is none other than Dr. Timothy O. Johnson. To our viewing audience, we thank God for you as well. We thank God for how you tune in every Sunday morning at 6 o'clock to hear the word of God. We're praying that the Lord continue to bless you and your family. Please know that you are welcome to attend any of these anointed services here at Greater Bible Way Temple, beginning on Wednesdays with 11 a.m. Bible class, then on Wednesday nights with 7 p.m. Bible class, which is taught by our pastor, Dr. Timothy O. Johnson. As well, you're welcome to come and join us on Sunday mornings, beginning at 9:45 with our Christian Education Department, where we are focusing on the family. After that, you will be hearing an anointed word of God, taught and preached by our pastor leader, the angel of this assembly, Dr. Timothy O. Johnson. And even on last week, you heard it this morning, that your praise takes the defeat out of everything that you've been going through. So you got to understand, you got to praise him, and you got to give him glory, and no matter what you go through. So you know what? You got to victory. I want you to know that we are getting your prayer request. Mrs. Rogers, we are praying for you. We got your request even on this morning. We are praying for your family. Now you are going to hear another selection by our male chorus. Next, after that, the voice you will hear will be none other than our pastor, Dr. Timothy O. Johnson, in Jesus' name.
All in love of Jesus, down in my heart, it makes me love everybody. Gave me a brand new song. No other love I know that brings joy down in my soul. I got the love of Jesus, hey, down in my heart. The Lord proved his love out on Calvary. When he hung, let him die. He died to set me free. He carried that cross so that we would not be lost. Then he placed his love in me. Now I'm happy as I can be. Oh, feeling low, it makes me love my enemies and treat my neighbors right. Love made me free. I'm gonna shout about the victory. Oh. love of Jesus.
I
got it down in my heart. Unconditional love. Let me show you the evidence. It ain't nothing but His love. When you see me treat my neighbor right, it ain't nothing but His love. Oh, down in my heart.
Down in my heart.
Oh, His love is in my heart. His love is in my heart. God's love is in my heart. His love is in my heart. It makes me pray for the sick. It makes me feed the hungry. His love, His love, His love, His love. One day when I was lost, He died on the cross. I'm glad, I'm glad, I'm glad, I'm glad. Pick me up, turn me around, place my feet solid ground. God's love, His love, His love, His love. I was lost, He saved me. Lost, He saved me. Lost, He found me. Put His arms all around me. His love, 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 His love. So glad, so glad, I'm so glad, so glad. Pick me up, pick me up, pick me up, pick me up. Save me, His love. Save me, His love. Fix my mind, my heart. Turn me around. Hey, hey, His love, His love, love, love. The love of Jesus down in my heart. Hallelujah. I used to sing a song years ago when I was coming up in the church. It says, deep, deep down in my heart, thank God, I've got the love. I've got the love of Jesus, and it's deep down in my heart. Why don't you just lean over and tell somebody, the Lord been good to me. You ought to tell them, say you may not believe it, but the Lord been sure enough good to me. Somebody ought to throw your head back and say, show enough. Oh, yeah.
than me. Lord has smiled on us, privileged us, and granted us this wonderful opportunity to be in the house of prayer on this morning, and certainly we should be grateful, and we should be thankful. The Bible says, enter into his courts with thanksgiving, into his gates with thanksgiving, his courts with praise. I think it says something like, be thankful unto him and bless his holy name. I'm so glad I brought my praise with me. I didn't come here depending on your praise. But I brought my praise with me. In fact, I carry it with me everywhere I go. You ought to try it sometime. You ought to try it sometime. Some of you have financial problems and what have you. But I challenge you, every time you pay a bill, you ought to break out in a praise. Hey. In fact, you owe God a praise. If you paid a bill Friday, you ought to take him, take your praise with you everywhere you go. Anybody just ever been driving in your car and all of a sudden that praise just stir up in you? Lord, have mercy. I want to be like the brother. They was having his funeral. Died pretty young, and his mother-in-law, she was quite old, and she said she wanted to say something at Percy's funeral. And they went to a restaurant to eat some fish, and when they brought the fish out, Brother Percy said, let us pray. And right there in the restaurant, as he began to bless the food, he went into a praise fit. And she said, it was something about my son-in-law. Whenever praise came up, praise came out. Hey! Lord, have mercy! Somebody ought to say, that's me too. Don't fool with me today. You let praise come up, praise gonna come out. You can't help but to say, glory, hallelujah. Lord, have mercy. You honor the Lord. On this Sunday morning, Lord, I feel it too. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. I'm gonna put a harness on you. This man done praised God in here so much so it done got hot in here. The Lord is good for real. Lord have mercy. I got to preach here, but my sermon, I tell you right now, is going to be for you, for our listening audience, but there's something moving in this house, and I believe if we could just get on one accord for about 30 seconds, something wonderful will happen in this place. Anybody just feel a push? Come on, let's praise it. You're going through and what's wrong with you? But I can hear old Bishop Moe say, I'm gonna shout about it now and tell you about it later. You ought to lean over and tell somebody, I'm gonna shout about it now, I'll tell you about it later. Psalms. Number 84 and 10. For a day in thy courts is better than a thousand. I'd had rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than to dwell in the tents of wickedness. I had rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than to dwell in the tents of wickedness. Thank you, Lord. My subject is the doorkeeper. May be seated. We thank God for all of our guests, friends that are with us on today, Elder Lady Anderson, thank God. It's always good to see our friends. Amen, amen. The doorkeeper, there's just a little ringing. The doorkeeper. This particular psalm is a somewhat of a prophetic utterance. Verse 9 says, Behold, O God, our shield, and look upon the face of thine anointed. For a day in thy courts is better than a thousand. I had rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than to dwell in the tents of wickedness. The doorkeeper. This particular job, as it pertained to the temple, the house of the Lord, the gates, the house of the Lord. To some, it was a humiliating task. To others, who had the responsibility being the doorkeeper, it was an honor. Because the doorkeeper's responsibility was to make certain or sure that no one unclean or unrighteous entered into the courts of the Lord, entered into the presence of the Lord, the house of the Lord. We are familiar with this verse of scripture being preached, I guess, during many church usher board anniversaries. And we use this scripture, use this scripture to say the doorkeeper is the ushers or the usher board. That's not the case at all. The doorkeeper's job was to separate the clean from the unclean, the righteous from the unrighteous. And so those men that entered in to the house of the Lord, the gates of the Lord, they had to be circumcised. They were considered unclean and could not enter the gates of the Lord or the presence of God, the house of God. It was a means by which that separated the righteous from the unrighteous. It was a covenant that was given to Abraham that was later detailed through the law of Moses to show that God had a separate people in the world, a peculiar people, a chosen people. We understand then that being the job of the doorkeeper, that job still must be active today as it pertains to the church. Jesus said, I did not come to destroy the law and the prophets, I came to fulfill. It is in the book of Isaiah, the 22nd chapter, around the 22nd verse, it speaks of the Lord in these terms. that the kingdom would be on his shoulders and he would have the keys, the house of David. And he would open doors that no man can shut, and he would shut doors that no man could open. In other words, the one that has the authority to open and shut doors is the Lord. The doorkeeper had authority. He had the authority either to allow individuals in or to keep individuals out. There's a simple word that represents this kind of authority. It is keys. In my home, thank God the doors are locked. No one has the authority to go in without a key. Because that's my home, just like your home. If someone goes in that does not have the authorization of the key, that's called breaking and entering. You're going to do 5 to 10. 5 to 10. It has to do with authority. We know that Isaiah, as he spoke in terms of God and the kingdom being on his shoulders, we know that to be Jesus. In Isaiah 9:6, it says, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, the government shall be upon his shoulders. His name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father." The government shall be upon his shoulders. He will have supreme authority. In the book of Revelations, the 3rd chapter, somewhere around the 7th verse, Jesus speaks to the church of Philadelphia and says, "Behold, I set before you an open door that no man can shut." That's authority. That's what that is. That's authority. And that kind of authority that God has, that he can open doors that no man can shut. And he can shut doors that no man can open. Remember, when Jesus met with his disciples and asked them a simple question, "Who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am?" Their response, some say that you are Elias, some say you're even John the Baptist or Isaiah, one of the prophets. Jesus looks and directly questions his disciples and says, "Who do you say that I am?" I would like to ask you also this morning, who do you say is? There's a lot of talk about who Jesus is. But I'm not worried about all of the conversations and all of the talk. What's important to me is what's important to him, and what's important to him is who do you say that I am? Concerned about how his church views him. When he came into the world, he came as a mystery man. He came into the world that he made, but the world knew him not. He's a mystery man. The one the Bible says, "Great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifested in the flesh." Peter, being the spokesman of the group, said, "Thou art the Christ, Son of the living God. You are the anointed one. You're the Messiah. Savior of the world. Jesus said, blessed art thou, Simon bar Jonah, for flesh and blood have not revealed this unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. And he says, and I say unto you, upon this rock I'm going to build my church, and the gates of hell, don't start us with Alexander, shall not prevail against it. He says to Peter, I say unto you, Peter, I'm going to give you the keys to the kingdom. Authority. Whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Peter, I'm giving you the keys. I'm giving you the keys, the authority to judge between the righteous and the unrighteous. I'm giving you the keys to keep out the unrighteous and to allow the righteous to come in. I'm giving you that authority, Peter. Peter then took the keys and he preached the gospel. The authority of the gospel preacher. Jesus, after his resurrection, gave commandments unto his disciples. In one place in the book of Mark, he said, preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. He that believeth not shall be damned. He told him to do one thing, preach the gospel. The results of the gospel, it is determined by the hearers. But you preach the gospel. I'm authorizing you to preach the gospel. You have the authority to preach the gospel. Those that believe and are baptized shall be saved. Those that believe not shall be damned. And these signs shall follow them that believe. Some of y'all are chasing signs. Signs supposed to follow us. Praise the Lord. My name, you're going to speak with new tongues. In my name, you have the authority to use my name. My name, you shall cast out devils. In my name, you're going to lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. That's authority. Peter preached the gospel on the day of Pentecost. You have not preached the gospel if you do not preach about a resurrected Savior. He did more than just going to Calvary, but the work of Calvary wasn't complete until he rose and ascended. Making atonement for our sins with his own blood. He preached the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And when he preached it, the Jews that were there in their feast day, they heard the gospel. And they realized that they were mistaken. They mistaken Jesus for a false Messiah. when they came to the realization that he indeed was the Christ, they were pricked to the heart and said to Peter and to the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? That wonderful response that we hear all the time. Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. You all know the story. With many other words that he testified and exhorts, saying, save yourselves from this untoward generation. Then they that gladly received the word were baptized. And the same day they were added to the church 3,000 souls. They continued steadfastly in apostles' doctrine, fellowship, breaking of bread. Signs and wonders were done by the hands of the apostles. And thank God, God added daily to the church such as should be saved. The door was open to the Jews on the day of Pentecost. Philip was led of the Lord, led of the Spirit of God to go down to Samaria. A place that was given over to witchcraft. But he preached Jesus. And he preached him being alive and well. And when they heard the gospel, they were baptized in Jesus' name. And you know, there's some power in the baptism. Because some that were sick just by being baptized in Jesus' name was healed. Some that were oppressed and depressed by demons just by being water baptized in Jesus' name, the devil had to go. Oh, there's power in the blood. Thank God. But none of them received the Holy Ghost until Peter and John went down, the man with the keys. And thank God when he laid his hands on them, prayed for them, the Holy Ghost came on them. Some say, well, did they speak in tongues? Yeah. Just like they did on their Pentecost. Well, you know, the Bible doesn't say that. Well, there was a sorcerer that testified that something happened. There were some signs of the impartation of the Holy Ghost because Simon said, I got some money. And I got a lot of potions, but I ain't never seen nothing like this. Y'all need to give me this, that whomsoever I lay my hands on, they receive the Holy Ghost. And Peter did everything short of cussing him out. He said, you're filled with the gall of bitterness and you're going to perish with your money. I want you to know that ain't no funny business when it comes to the Holy Ghost. Now there's a lot of ghosts out here. But there's nothing like the Holy Ghost. There's a lot of shaking going on. But there's nothing like when the Holy Ghost shakes you. Can I get a witness here? You can shake, you can quake, but just make sure it's God. Because everything that's shaking and quaking is not the Holy Ghost. In the 10th chapter of the book of Acts, we find that Peter didn't want to go, but there was a praying man there by the name of Cornelius. Giving man, a kind man. Thank God, God dealt with Cornelius to send for Peter. When God dealt with Cornelius, God also dealt with Peter. When they came together, it couldn't have been nothing but power. Because God dealt with Cornelius and God dealt with Peter. You know, that's the kind of witness I like. I like the kind of witness when the Lord lays an individual on my heart. And I can call them and say, you know, Lord laid you on my heart. And they say, you know what? The Lord was just dealing with me about you too. And it's like the power of God moves in the witness. The Bible says that Peter went down and preached Jesus Christ, the resurrected Savior, the judge of the living and the dead. Thank God the Holy Ghost fell on them that heard the word. And those Jews that was with Peter was astonished, because on the Gentiles also poured out to give the Holy Ghost. For they heard them speak with tongues and magnify God. Then answered Peter, can any man forbid water that these should not be baptized, which have received the Holy Ghost as well as we? They received the Spirit of God just like we received the Spirit of God. And I'm so happy I received the Spirit of the Lord just like Cornelius and received the Spirit of the Lord. And they received the Spirit of the Lord just like they did on their Pentecost. He's still pouring out his Spirit. Thank God. Peter looked at these tongue talkers fresh from their spiritual baptism and said, can any man forbid water that these should not be baptized which have received the Holy Ghost as well as we? The Bible didn't say he asked him politely and said, would you like to be baptized in Jesus' name? The Bible says he commanded them to be baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Peter had the keys. So some are wondering, well, what does that have to do with the doorkeeper? Remember now, the doorkeeper separated the clean from the unclean, the righteous from the unrighteous. Everybody couldn't go in. Praise the Lord. What makes then Peter and the gospel preacher the doorkeeper? The Bible says, in whom also ye are circumcised with the circumcision made without hands, and the putting off the body of sins and of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ, buried with him in baptism, which also ye are risen with him through faith of the operation of God, who raised him from the dead. The doorkeeper. The doorkeeper's job was to separate the righteous from the unrighteous. The doorkeeper's job was to make sure that no unclean person was allowed to come into the gates in the house of the Lord. Oh, praise the Lord. Thank God for the doorkeeper. There is a doorkeeper. And the doorkeeper's job is to preach the gospel. Hallelujah. And when the gospel is preached, it separates the clean from the unclean. It separates the unrighteous from the righteous. Can the church shout hallelujah? I'm getting ready to close now, but I feel like running, because I want you to understand, you wouldn't be here if it wasn't for the doorkeeper. You wouldn't be able to be called righteous and clean if somebody didn't preach Jesus to you. You ought to thank God that you have the circumcision that's made without hands. You ought to thank God that you had faith in the operation of God. You ought to thank God that now that you're born again, now that you're baptized in Jesus' name, now that you've been filled with the Holy Ghost, enter into his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his name, for the Lord is good. Can I get a witness here? Lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be lifted up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is the King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty. Can the church say amen? You ought to thank God for the doorkeeper. You ought to thank God for the preacher. You ought to thank God for the gospel. And most of all, you ought to thank God you believed it. You ought to thank God. You ought to give him a praise for the doorkeeper. And let me say this. The doorkeeper job is not just to preach the gospel, but the doorkeeper's job is to make sure that everybody in the church be clean. I can't get no help in here. I heard the Bible say judgment begins at the house of God. And if it first begin at us, where shall the sinner, the ungodly, the unrighteous appear? I heard Paul tell the Corinthian church, are ye not worthy to judge the smallest matters that may arise among you? Know ye not that you should judge the world? Know ye not that you should judge angels? I come to tell you, whether you like it or not, God wants a clean, sanctified, holy church. You got to be careful coming in the presence of God, unclean and unrighteous and unholy. The Bible says, and such were some of you. I can't get nobody to help me praise him in here. I feel a pullback, but I feel like pressing on anyhow. Such was some of you, but you're washed, you're sanctified, you're justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God. God wants a clean people that comes before his presence. God wants a righteous people to stand before his presence. Can the church shout hallelujah? That's why the doorkeeper here tells you, come out from among them and be ye separated, saith the Lord. That's why the doorkeeper keep telling you this is a sanctified church. You can't come in God's presence any kind of way. You come before God just any kind of way, you're going to get yourself in trouble. Give me some help here. You're going to get yourself in trouble. The priest had to minister at the tabernacle. When they ministered at the tabernacle, they had to wash. They had to be clean. They just couldn't come in their ordinary clothes. They just couldn't come any kind of way. They had to be clean. They had to be sober. They had to be living righteous. They had to have the law of God in their heart. Well, yes, and God would honor those priests that brought those sacrifices in holiness and in righteousness, because they understood we're serving a holy and a righteous God. Thank God there were some sons of one high priest by the name of Eli. Eli had two sons, Hophni and Phinehas. And they were so wicked until they had no righteousness in their hearts at all. They were adulterers and fornicators. They had it so bad until they were laid with the women right at the door of the tabernacle. But oh, one day God said, enough is enough. Eli, you won't do nothing, but I'm going to do something about this, because my priests are supposed to be clean. My priests are supposed to be righteous. I can't get no help in here. But I come to tell you, amen, while they were out there in the battle, on the battlefield, and the priests were there representing the presence of God, God allowed Hophni and Phinehas to be cut down and to be cut off because of their sin. I want you to know, church, God does not want sin in his church. He doesn't want unrighteousness in his church. Thank God he cut them off. Eli should have judged them, but God had to cut them off. Oh, yeah. And Eli, when he got news that his sons had died, he was a big man, fell out of his chair, out of the top story window, and broke his neck. But one of those boys' daughters, or one of those boys' wives, were pregnant, and she had a baby. And when the baby was born, Hophni and Phinehas and Eli were gone. And the handmaiden that delivered the baby looked at the woman and said, look what God has done. He still got a priestly lineage. But that woman looked up at that handmaiden and said, I got a name for this boy. His name is Ichabod, which means the glory of the Lord has departed. I want you to know, Greater Bibleway, we just got done shouting, and the presence of God came down. The glory of the Lord filled the house. But I don't want to be in an Ichabod church. You got to live a
hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Jesus saves.
Jesus saves.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
You save by grace.
I'm so glad
in the Lord, Jesus said,